And you're opening your heart to Him. And you're wanting to follow Him. And there's no bad prayers. Try not to shoot on yourself. Well, I should be praying for this, or I should be praying for that, or I don't know why I don't pray. You know, there's nobody here that's got the perfect prayer life. You can just put that to the side. Instead of shooting on yourself and just, well, I don't know this. Just get involved. Start praying. Start praying. It's like exercise. I don't know what I'm doing. Well, just start exercising. You got to start somewhere. I know for myself and biking, the reason why I bike is because I got bad ankles. And biking's not bad. You know, eventually, the other night, I biked over 100 miles in one day. But that didn't happen just overnight. But you got to start somewhere. Start somewhere. Our prayers reveal our heart desires and our priorities. If you want to know about someone's heart, listen to their prayers. This is what's important. This is what's important. What do you think God prays about? It talks about in Hebrews that He is ever making intercession for us. What's God praying about? What's on His heart? I'm going to go to a passage where the Apostle Paul's praying. But if the Apostle Paul would come to this church and observe us, what would be his prayer? What would he be praying? He want us to pray about? What do you and I really need? What do you think? Paul has this wonderful apostolic prayer in Ephesians chapter 1. And he's talking to this group of Christians. When I've heard your faith in Lord Jesus is present in your community and of your great love for all, I haven't stopped thanking Him for you. I thank God for you guys.
We need to talk about that. Would Paul pray for this congregation?
Okay.
Yeah, they show up to church on the time. Ouch.
Wow. Good morning, everybody. How are you? I want to be here. Okay, we're going to start now. Everybody's on time. Okay. Done.
Can I say what I think he would pray?
Yeah.
I think he would pray that we light fire in us again, that we need to be on fire from God and to show passion.
It's a good prayer. It was many years ago in devotional. I'm not sure. Yeah, a couple of years ago in devotional. I went through this. He would have this name. He would write things out. One of the devotionals was about enthusiasm. And he broke down the word enthusiasm. Theo is in the middle of enthusiasm. Theo is the Greek word for God. And someone that's enthusiastic is infused with God. Passion. That's what we're talking about. Okay, good. The passage that I'm going to go to is, it's a simple passage, but it's a powerful passage. This is out of Ephesians chapter 1, starting in verse 15. When I heard of the faith in the Lord Jesus, the person of the community, and the great love, I haven't stopped thanking them for you. Thank God. I do that for you all. I thank God for you. And then he goes on, I am continually speaking to God, that's him, on your behalf in my prayers. And here's what I say. This is not a one-time prayer that Paul is praying. This is a constant prayer. He prays over the churches, over this church. I believe this is God's heart that he's praying for us. This is God's prayer for us. The God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Anointed, the Father of glory, I call out to you, God, on behalf of your people. Give them minds ready to receive wisdom and revelation so they will truly know you. Let's just think about it. If we would truly know God, what's there to worry about if we really knew him? What would ever be, what's the big concern if we know who God really is? That he's all powerful, that he lives in us, that he's ever interceding for us, that he will meet every one of us. This is who he is. This is the God. If we really knew God, we'd be solid people. We wouldn't have to be floating up and down and this and that. I believe many of us, all of us here, know about God. Do you know God? What does it look like to know him? I believe if we knew him, I don't think we would have the issues. What issues are there? How many know with God you are a part of the majority now? All power is in God. All strength is in God. All knowledge is in God. All wisdom is in God. What's there to be concerned if you know him? Now, know is not an intellectual knowledge. There are different types of know. There's intellectual knowing. There's knowing through observation. I remember it was some months ago, the first time Eleanor, pray for her, I don't know where she is. She's somewhere between here in Chicago. But anyway. She was called upon to be the worship leader. The first time she tried, it was like for 3 weeks. The first week, it wasn't that bad. The second week, it was starting to, it looked easier than it seemed. She knew by observation what to do, but when you're actually here, it's different. And then there's knowing experientially. That's what's going on here. Open their heart, eyes of, let's see, open the eyes of their heart before them. Get their minds ready to receive wisdom and knowledge so that they will truly, they would experientially know you. They would know you in practical life, experientially on an everyday basis, that people would know you. If we would know God in a practical way. I remember being in Sunday school at the first church where I was pastor. They would open up their quarterlies, talk about the Bible, talk about many spiritual things. But they never got practical. It was always these spiritual conversations about God and following Him and this and that. But what does it look like in life? What's it look like when you're in relationships where people don't like you? How do you do that at home? With family members? How do you do that when you on the highway? How do you do that in a normal everyday life in making decisions? That it just seemed so removed. It wasn't practical. Give them minds ready to receive wisdom and revelation so they will truly know you, God. Open the eyes of their hearts and let the light of your truth flood in. Shine your light on the hope you are calling them to embrace. Some translations say that the hope to which we've been called. Just think, if you knew what you're calling, you'd wake up every day, you know why God put you on the earth. You would have a spring in your step. You're not here just to punch the clock and do your stuff. You got a divine purpose. This is what, that you would know that this is why He put you on the earth. You would know that He put you on the earth in that job with those kids every day, Glenda. There's a purpose there. It's not just to get through so that 5:15 would show up and you're done. That's not it. That we would know the hope of our calling. That truth would flood into us. Reveal to them the glorious riches you're preparing as their inheritance. God has given us a bunch of riches right now and in the future. Let them see the full extent of your power that is at work in those who believe. And may it be done according to your might. That we would know the power that God has in our life. Do you know what kind of power God has in your life? When you ask Jesus to come into your life, what kind of power is in your life? He goes on. Friends, it's the same might and the resurrection power that He used to the anointed one to raise Him from the dead. Did you know that resurrection power? Can you imagine resurrection power, the same power that raised Jesus from the dead, is in you? Do you know that? Do you know that you have that kind of power? What if we knew that we had that kind of power? What would stop us? What would depress us? What would discourage us? What would hold us back if we knew that we knew that we knew? Ask God. Everybody's got a knower here. There's a knower inside you. We need revelation in our knower. That we would know that we know and they know that the same power that raised Christ from the dead dwells in you and dwells in me. That's the kind of power. What should discourage us? What should depress us? There is nothing over Him. How do you like that statement? There is nothing over Him. He's above all rule. He's above your employer? Yes, He is. He's above Trump? Yes, He is. He's above Congress? Yes, He is. He's above the world leaders? Yes, He is. He's above most of the rules, right? What's it say there? All rule, all authority, all power, all dominion, over every name and vote, over every title bestowed in this age. That means right now. Right now, God is over it all. What if you knew that God was over everything in your life, and there's nothing that's slipping out from under God, that's sort of coming into your life. If you knew that God was over everything that's ever come into your life. No, God's got a plan. We don't have to be not our throne. Unless our throne's not connected to His throne. We've got our own throne. Over every title bestowed in this age and the next, God has placed all things beneath His feet and anointed Him as the head over all things. His church. This church is His body, the fullness of the one who fills all in all. He's placed all things over His feet. Beneath His feet and anointed Him as head over all things. He did this for the church. So in this world, as far as authority is concerned, there's God, then there's the church. The church has more authority in this world and should make a bigger difference in this world than the world would in the church and all that kind of stuff. We have authority, we have power. God, did you know that you're above the circumstances because everything's beneath His feet? Are you living under the circumstances or over the circumstances? Well, under the circumstances, this isn't going on. Everything's beneath His feet. Are you in Him? See, if we knew these things, life would be different. So whole life worship, a life that's lived for Him, begins and is sustained by perspective. How do we get perspective? How do we get perspective in life? How do we know what we know? Let's just think about it. How do we know what we know?
We learned it.
By? Came to some conclusions. We had to come to some conclusions along the way that what people said was true or how they conducted themselves were right or what I like or what I don't like. We perceive and we believe a lot through the conclusions that we've come to in life. What we perceive is what we believe. Our main problem, according to Paul, is that we don't know God. We don't see Him. What if you'd actually see Him at your work? Do you see Him there? Do you see Him with the people? Do you see Him in your boss? Do you see Him in your co-workers? Do you see Him around your kids? Do you see Him with your family? He's there! He's over all, isn't it what it said? He's in all and over all. And you have all the power that you need. And He's called you. I don't see my calling. I don't see that. It's because we need our eyes opened. How many need their eyes open? How many know? It's hard to worship when we don't see right. How many know that? Because we're not seeing right. Hard to worship when we don't see. It's hard to praise God. It's hard to be victorious when we're blinded. It's not money, it's not time, it's not talent, it's not resources, it's not people. Our issue, a little revelation and understanding about who God is and who we are in God, who God is in us. If we understood who we are in God, God in us, and who God really is. We can start growing. Ephesians is put together. Watchman Nee has this simple. He put puts it together through three words: sit, walk, and stand. In Ephesians chapter 6, it talks about standing against the enemy. In chapter 3, in chapter 4, in chapter 5, it talks about our walk. But in chapters 1 and 2, it talks about sitting. Until we are seated in Christ and know who we are in Him. How many of you have you ever said this to someone? Just sit down. It's okay. Just sit down. Relax. If we are seated in Jesus and know who we are in Jesus, then we'll be able to walk in Him. And we'll be able to stand against the enemy. But if we are not seated in Christ and don't know who we are in Christ, and we don't know who Christ is in us, we can't walk the Christian life or stand against the enemy. We can't do it. We're trying to fight the enemy, but we don't even know who we are or who God is. We're trying to walk this Christian life, but we don't know who we are and we don't know who God is. It starts with being seated in Him and knowing who Christ is and who He is in us. We can't really live this life. It's sit, walk, and stand. Through what lens do you see the world? How do we know who people really are? Think about that passage in 2 Corinthians 5. It says, before I knew Jesus, Paul says, I saw people from a wrong point of view. And this one fellow, he got on my nerves. He would come to church sometimes, because he was dating this one guy. But it's like he didn't even want to be there. I don't know, it was weird. And he just got on my nerves. Because he just had this critical attitude, right? I don't know, I was in this hotel room in Indiana. We were at some conference. I was just praying out the back of the hotel room. I just went out the back, they had this area, and I don't know, I was just praying out there. And all of a sudden, God says, I want to show you who this person is. I mean, I wasn't praying about the guy. But God gave me a revelation and understanding. This guy was running away from God, and God has a call in his life. He's called him into the ministry. And that's why he's miffed. That's why he didn't really want to be there, because he's really not following me. I saw him. My whole attitude changed about it. So I understand what that's about. So I said, okay, Lord, next time I see him, I'm going to talk to him about this.
So, you moved away from your judgment.
Oh, because I had a whole brand new perspective, because I was seeing through God's eyes. When I see other people through God's eyes, I don't see them in my eyes anymore, and then I'll treat them completely differently. What now?
That's
it's like a Photoshop.
So it was completely different. So here I am, I talk to this guy. I pull him off to the side, you know, I started confessing to him. I said, you know, I had different ideas of who you were, and I don't even think they were that good. I know they weren't that good. But I was praying, and I was in Indiana. I told him the story about what I saw. I said, this is what I understood from God, that He has a call on your life. And that you really haven't responded to the fact that you've been running from that. And he looked at me, he says, that's exactly right. What if we would see children, Have you ever done this before? You're coming in to, maybe on a worship service here. We're singing, and all of a sudden we're singing some of these worship songs. All of a sudden, God's playing around with your heart and letting you see from another perspective. And all of a sudden, things open up to you, and you let things go, and you accept different things, and your whole attitude gets shifted because you're in worship. You understand what I'm talking about? And the words come up to you in a different way, because when we start lifting God up, we change. There's something about music that engages the heart and opens the heart. And that's what's powerful about it. And if you have the word in there, the word can get down in the heart. It almost bypasses our mind and gets down to where it really needs to go. Worship in God gives us fresh insight. Here's my question. Whole life worship, when we worshiping God, all of a sudden we realize God is sovereign. Paul said, there's nothing over Jesus. God and his church have authority over the world, over circumstances, over the devil, over the government, over rulers, over your boss, over sin, over death. The only reason that God doesn't have authority over your life is what? Is what? Yeah, but why? But why? Yeah, but what is that? Because you don't get it. You don't get God. You don't get his vision. You don't get his understanding. You don't get who he really is. You don't get his knowledge. You don't see through his eyes. That's the problem. If you really saw it as God saw it, God doesn't have authority over our life because we don't see it. Have you ever saw something and tried to convince somebody else of seeing something? How does that work?
Tried to change them.
How does that work? You see this, and it's obvious to you, and you're trying to convince so-and-so over here. Severed, but you know what? Have you ever struggled with algebra 2?
Yes.
Struggled with multiplication.
Did you ever struggle with algebra 2? Or the first time you really had these equations that x plus y equals, you know, all this kind of stuff, and then you're getting into it and you say, I don't get it. And you just said, but all of a sudden when the revelation comes, it's easy. All of a sudden, I understand. I can do it. But you can't do it unless you get a revelation of how it really works. It doesn't matter how hard you try. I believe one of the premier reasons that God doesn't have authority over life because we don't get it. We don't understand him. We don't see through his eyes. We don't see how he sees. We don't see life how he sees. We don't see his marriage like he would see our marriage. We don't see relationships like he sees relationships. We don't see money like he sees money. We don't see time like he sees time. We don't see our life like he sees our life. Does that make sense? Because if we really did, we would change and get on his page. Of our heart. many know that before Jesus opened your eyes, Jesus didn't mean anything? How many of us know that? Before God opened our eyes. I went to church when I was a kid and boring as fuck.
I was like, man, was this over?
I was looking at my clock. I was waiting to get out of there. I was bored out of my gourd. Until I got to Jesus, then all of a sudden this had life. There was meaning. There was purpose. It was alive. Same setting, same people, same everything.